Welcome everybody to this event for the Cambridge Festival. It's an event which is co-sponsored by the Cambridge Climate Lecture Series and by Cambridge Zero. And we're very pleased to welcome Holly Buck and Oliver Morton to an event on talking about the subject of geoengineering. We're recording this evening, so you'll be able to see the recording later on YouTube after the event is finished. We're also inviting you to put questions to Holly and Oliver in the Q&A facility, which you'll see down the bottom of your screen. And we're also inviting you to upvote questions from others that you find interesting so that we make sure that the questions that are of most interest to you get put to our speakers. The Cambridge Climate Lecture Series was launched in 2017 after the death of David Mackay. Now, in Cambridge, David was a big figure and he put us all on the right track with regard to sustainable energy and climate change. We were very sorry to lose him, and we've been running this festival, this series, every year since 2017. And we've been hosting an event at the Cambridge Science Festival, and this year the Cambridge Festival as part of the Cambridge Climate Lecture Series. Well, the last event that we held was on the 11th of March. It's available to watch on YouTube. And it was an extraordinary panel looking at climate justice. I would urge you to have a look at that panel. It was an extraordinary discussion on all sorts of aspects of climate action and climate justice. Tonight, we're very pleased to be hosted by Emily Shuckburgh. She will be the chair of this evening. She is the director of Cambridge Zero, and I'm sure she will have a little bit to say about Cambridge Zero as I pass over to her now, and she will introduce the speakers and get the evening going. So without further ado, I'd like to hand over now to Emily Shuckburgh.
Thank you very much, Hugh. And I can't believe that it is a year ago that we were actually in a real lecture theatre with a real live audience in front of us at what was, at least for me, the very last event that we did before lockdown, which was last year's Cambridge Climate Lecture Series and Cambridge Festival event. So I don't think we would have imagined back then that a year later we would still be doing everything virtually. Sadly, that's the way, but it's a real pleasure that so many of you are able to join us, at least online, tonight for this, what I hope is going to be a really exciting session. So tonight we're looking at what some see as being the radical fringes of climate science, so-called geoengineering, a label that's perhaps starting to fall out of favor, but is something that embraces technologies to cool the planet. And these technologies are either reflecting sunlight back into space or looking at ways of removing carbon dioxide from the atmosphere, hence the title of tonight's double act, solar versus carbon geoengineering. I know that at least one of our speakers significantly objects to that title because he's significantly concerned that it might end up in some face-off between him and the other panelists. So apologies for that. Before I introduce the speakers, let me, as Hugh says, just say a tiny little bit about Cambridge Zero. So Cambridge Zero is the university's climate change initiative. Much of what we're focused around is research, joining up research across the university, in particular to look at how we can help support a zero carbon future, as well as a strong educational component. But another really key pillar of what we're trying to do as part of Cambridge Zero is engage more broadly, and events such as this, and some of you might have come to some of our climate change festival events at the end of last year, are exactly the sort of things that we want to be doing more of to engage a wider group of people in the debate around climate change. So let's get on to tonight's event and introduce the speakers to you. First of all, we have Oliver Morton. Oliver is the Economist's briefing editor. He also served as the Economist's energy and environment editor. And before that, he was chief news and features editor of Nature. His powerful book, Planet Remade, explores the science, history, and politics behind geoengineering, and he unpicks the moral implications of our responses to climate change and imagines a world where people take care of the climate instead of taking control. He's been a really faithful supporter of the Cambridge Climate Lecture Series since its inception, chairing science festival events in Cambridge every year since 2017. And it's a real pleasure to have you back again, Oliver, joining us by Zoom from London. Our second speaker is Professor Holly Buck, and she is joining us from Buffalo, New York. One of the benefits of moving virtually is that we can have speakers from across the world without incurring their carbon footprint. Her expertise is in climate change policy, geoengineering, carbon capture, and environmental justice. She's published extensively on the politics of carbon removal, and her 2019 book, After Geoengineering, Climate Tragedy, Repair and Restoration, examines topics such as industrial seaweed farms, large-scale carbon sequestration, restoration of wetlands and reforestation. And she's also written about uncertainties surrounding solar geoengineering, in which hypothetically tiny aerosols could be injected into the atmosphere to block solar radiation. She's interested in how communities can adapt to climate change and how the public and environmental groups engage with emerging technologies. So I'm really looking forward to the discussion this evening. As Hugh said at the start, if you have questions, you can put them into the Q&A function on Zoom. And we're going to not only be discussing experimenting with the climate, but we're also going to experiment with the Q&A function. So we're going to see whether or not we can get the technology to work such that when we come to the Q&A session, we will try and unmute those people who are have questions to ask so that you can ask them verbally. We'll hope that that technology works. And if you want to upvote certain questions, then you have that ability to do that with the Q&A function as well. So that's the introduction. I'm going to hand the floor immediately now over to Oliver to start the discussion. Oliver.
Thank you very much, Emily. Okay, there's a button there. I suppose I should show some slides. Thank you all very much for coming to the extent that you came somewhere or attending. That's the thing to thank you for. Thank you very much for attending. And let me talk a little bit about solar geoengineering, which should be doable like this. There we go. So this is a picture of Prometheus, who some of you will remember was a Titan. He took the fire of the gods and gave it to mortals. And for his pains in this respect, he had his liver pecked out for all of eternity. And he's a good way to begin this because there's a concept promulgated by one of the greatest current Cambridge professors, and also my friend Simon Schaffer, who defined this idea of Promethean science, an experimental enterprise that mixes a vaulting ambition to safeguard humanity against a major threat with the troubling hazards of following this science's recipes. And the Promethean science that Simon was talking about in that essay was that very, very disturbing idea of the lightning conductor. The lightning conductor is a very problematic technology in the 18th century for a number of reasons. One is that it may not work and may burn your house down instead. And this is definitely a troubling hazard. More generally, it may be to take power that you do not deserve or need. And so it's not. So, for instance, Immanuel Kant refers to Benjamin Franklin, whose house you see here, the pioneer of the lightning conductor, as the modern Prometheus, and it's not entirely a positive thing. The idea that a technology might give you a power that you do not deserve, that is not warranted, is quite a deep idea in Western culture, and it's associated with Faust and with, and of course, with Frankenstein, the subtitle of which is The Modern Prometheus. So this is a Promethean science in that I think it is genuinely something that attempts to, really does attempt to safeguard humanity. I think the intentions of people working on solar geoengineering are in those, along those lines. And it does indeed have troubling hazards, both practical, if you can call things on the whole level of the planet practical, but also ideological, social, almost aesthetic. So this is what we're talking about with solar geoengineering. The sun shines onto the Earth. If less sunshine gets to the Earth's surface, the Earth warms up less. So one way of doing this is to scatter sunshine in the stratosphere, and that's what I'll be talking about mostly. The other way to do this is to scatter sunshine lower down here with the clouds over the sea. We're not going to go into this bit of the story because it's confusing not really germane to the core issues. So here are two ideas about how the sort of people who talk positively about solar geoengineering, I wouldn't call them advocates. I think it's very hard to find someone that you would call a flat out advocate for doing this. But the people who think that it's a worthwhile thing to research, look at charts, ideas like this. And so here the idea is, these are actually charts from Maria Belaya. And here you have the idea that if things go on, temperatures just go up. Don't really pay any attention to the numbers. I don't think we need to pay attention to numbers. But the baseline is people keep emitting and temperatures keep going up. Now, the second level down here is that people slow down emitting through mitigation, through reduction, through reducing emissions. And at some point, emissions get down to zero, at which point the temperature stabilizes. Then you have the idea that if you did this sunshine blocking, you could have that same mitigation pathway, but you could also get a further reduction in temperature through doing some solar geoengineering, through increasing the amount of light reflected from the Earth. And then you could also get the temperature to actually start coming down by taking carbon dioxide out of the atmosphere, which is what Holly will be talking about. And here you can actually mix the two together, and you see that if you mitigate and take carbon dioxide and do solar geoengineering, you get the nicest curve of all. Well, everyone wants not the nicest curve of all. The problem with this picture is that many people will say that in the real world of society and politics, these are not independent functions. And the moment that you start bringing in the orange line here, your hopes of getting that green line of mitigation go out the window, because people say, oh, well, if we're doing some solar geoengineering, we don't need to do so much mitigation. Now, I should stress that pretty much everyone who researches this is, I think actually everyone who researches this thinks that that's not what should happen. No one is arguing that solar geoengineering is a fundamental alternative to carbon to emissions reduction. Everyone thinks that emissions reduction is primary, everyone who works in this area, that emissions reduction is primary, and that solar geoengineering might provide you something extra like this. However, almost everyone in the field is also aware that they can't prove, whatever they could or could not prove about the biogeochemical, biogeophysical effects of solar geoengineering, which are moderately uncertain, no one can prove that it won't stop people from mitigating. And so immediately, a lot of the discussion about geoengineering, solar geoengineering, becomes a discussion about what you think of both humanity generally and the current political economic arrangement of industrial parts of humanity, as to whether you think that mitigation will continue if you are doing solar geoengineering. So this story all comes about to some extent. There are stories about trying to control the climate and the weather that go back yonks. But the story about modern sort of solar geoengineering is given its big push by this wonderful man who sadly died earlier this year, Paul Crutzen, who was a great Dutch atmospheric scientist, one of the only atmospheric scientists ever to win a Nobel Prize, and a magnificent advocate of and creative thinker about the protection of the Earth system. And in 2006, Paul wrote this essay called, very off-puttingly, Albedo Enhancement by Stratospheric Sulfur Injections, a Contribution to Resolve a Policy Dilemma. The policy dilemma was this. Paul was pointing out that at the moment, people, certainly in 2006 even more so, the Earth is covered with a blanket of choking fumes created by industrial pollution in the lower atmosphere, which kills hundreds of thousands, millions of people every year from breathing in these particles. And absolutely reasonably and absolutely properly, people are trying to reduce the amount, this burden on the lower atmosphere, and thus clean the lungs of the world, which, especially after the last year, everyone can agree, you know, that's what we want to do. Paul's point, and why this was a policy dilemma, was that by reducing the amount of particles in the lower atmosphere, you reduce the amount of sunlight that is reflected off back into the cosmos. And if you do that successfully, you will improve the health of the world. You will save hundreds of thousands, millions of lives. But at the same time, you will contribute to a further warming of the planet, because at the moment, this sulfur is cooling the planet. And Paul's contribution was to say, why not put a small amount of sulfur in the stratosphere, where it doesn't get breathed, instead of having a large amount in the lower atmosphere? And for reasons that we can go into in discussion, if you would like, that the amount of sulfur you need in the stratosphere is much, much less than the amount that we currently have near the surface of the Earth. And so Paul suggested putting a very thin global smog around the planet in order to cool it, while at the same time removing the thick and noxious smogs from near the surface. And it's important to notice, incidentally, that it's often remarked that solar geoengineering mimics volcanoes. And though it's true that volcanoes cool the Earth, it really doesn't try to mimic volcanoes. And that analogy can be severely overused. It's much more like a thin smog that's not hurting you. Doesn't sound nice, but it's not really in the same league as a volcano. Anyway, this is Paul's conclusion. I want to bring out two points. One is that he thought in 2006 that this sort of geoengineering should be researched. The second is he thought that it would be much better if you could get rid of the greenhouse gases, stop emitting them completely. But he also felt that, and I quote him here, that looks like a pious wish. And if it did then, it does now. And it's possible, indeed, that what Paul's talking about is now actually becoming seen. I don't think this is definite, but I think it's worth saying, partly because when Jim Hansen talks about the climate since 1988 or so, it's behooved the rest of us to listen. And so this is something that Jim Hansen, who's one of America's great climate scientists, wrote last December, where he was looking at the fact that the Earth is now warming faster than you might expect from the trend, even though the emissions aren't going up any faster. And he suspects, and this is an idea that's been developed quite a lot by the people he used to work with at the Goddard Institute for Space Sciences in New York. James suggests that this is because we are seeing this unveiling. We are being successful enough. In particular, China is cutting down its sulfur emissions very successfully, scrubbing them out of the emissions. And so the Earth is becoming less reflective as the lower atmosphere cleans up, and thus it is warming quicker. And this is the business end of that chart. Now, not everyone would agree with James Hansen on this. If you look the earlier bit of the red here, that's what people were calling the hiatus when the in warming some time back when it and it was really just a small fluctuation, if a fluctuation at all. And this is the increase that James is talking about. Now, some people would say that's not really, that that's just a little variation, a natural climate variability. But it's interesting that a man as insightful as Hansen is actually talking about this deal of poles, this, and I should say, Jim Hansen is not in favor of solar geoengineering, but he's talking about this trade-off of poles as though it's really already happening now. So a little personal history, I got into this when I was working at Nature, as Emily mentioned, and this was the first big piece I wrote on geoengineering. And it's interesting, we'll come back to this, the question at the top is still basically the question people are asking today. And this ends this piece by talking about something which I think is quite fundamental, that natural scientists and climate and those imbued with the spirit of climate action want to make very large changes to society because they don't want to see large changes to the system that the Earth works by. They do not want to see an artificial planet. They do not want to see, in the words of a later book, a planet remade. They want to do everything that they can to push back towards what they conceive of as the natural, rather than accept that humans are so much part of the Earth system that they might politically start to attempt to govern it or misgovern it. So that was my contribution. The questions have continued to be asked and be answered in books. This is one that Holly edited last year or this year, I can't remember. I like it because, is this what it takes to save the world? Has it come to this? They're basically almost the same sentiment. This is a recent book by Elizabeth Colbert, which is also about geoengineering, about the idea, which is not in fact particularly true, that solar geoengineering, this smog around the world, might actually blank out the sky. And indeed, another book that's about to come out, Imagining Climate Engineering. There's a lot of discussion of this, but I don't want to get into history because I want to tell you, oh, I'm not sure why that slide repeated. Here you are. This is how bang up to the minute Cambridge Climate Lecture Series, Climate Change Lecture Series is. This is a report, and it may turn out to be quite an important report, which was published yesterday. You, having thought you were coming out for some interesting Friday evening intellectual stimulation, you're actually in a hot news event or a cooling news event. This is a report by America's National Academies of Science, which has looked at geoengineering before, and it was released yesterday. And it's interesting to see what it has to say and what it has to show. These are the technologies it's talking about. That's the... Sorry, I realize you can't see me when I point at the screen. that's the brightening of low-level clouds over the sea. This is the thickening of layers of dust in the stratosphere. And that's the cirrus thing that I'm not talking about. You'll notice that part of how the debate hasn't really changed is that these are, in fact, exactly the same illustrations as were in my Nature piece in 2007. And the links are not just there. It's I think very fitting that this report was dedicated to Paul Crutzen and also to my dear friend Steve Rayner, who died last year. A very different sort of man from Paul, a social scientist, an anthropologist, but someone who was not so much a transdisciplinary scholar, he used to say, as an undisciplined scholar, but an unbelievably insightful and both precise and broad thinker, and we're very sad to have lost him. So how does this report compare to the thoughts of Paul Crutzen, to whom it's dedicated? Well, here are Crutzen's conclusions, and here's what the report says. Crutzen said, we need to do this research into geoengineering. The National Academy of Sciences report says, yeah, we need to do research into geoengineering. Paul says, I'd really rather not. I'd really rather we were doing away with the emissions, but that's not happening. National Academy of Sciences says, you know, we'd like to not be doing this, but as it turns out, over the last 10 years, emissions have increased by 10%. you know, most of the emissions that are causing the problem have been emitted within my lifetime, and probably many of yours as well. And the problem has not in any way gone away. It's true that emissions have been lower this year because of the COVID pandemic, and it may well, touch wood, be true that emissions are beginning to peak. But remember, what you need for those curves that Maria provided at the beginning is not for emissions to peak, but for them to be reduced to zero or to net zero, which I imagine Holly might talk about. Difference with Paul Crutzen is that this National Academy of Sciences report goes into a lot of detail about the sort of research that it would like to see, and notice that it wants to research not just the actual impacts and technical dimensions of the problem, but also why you might want such a schedule, such a strategy, and what the social dimensions are. And it also stresses very strongly that any research program along these lines must have off-ramps. There must be places where people can say, you know, yeah, this is just looking like a bad idea, let's stop. And so that's the bulk of the report, and very interesting it is too, or I'm sure it will be when I've read it in detail, having only had a chance to skim its 250 pages between yesterday afternoon and today. But the really interesting thing about the report is not only that it lays out what it thinks should be done, it also lays out how much it thinks should be paid for this. And this is where things get interesting for the solar geoengineering community. The report's saying that a reasonable initial investment in order to do its recommendation 6.1, which is this little diagram here, is something like $100 to $200 million spent over 5 years. And that would be a massive increase in the amount that is spent on solar geoengineering research worldwide. They're not remotely in this report talking about doing it. They're talking purely about research, and they provide some interesting ideas for how to limit what sorts of research might be done. But they are suggesting a really significant increase in funding. And when the American National Academy of Sciences says such things, quite a lot of people listen, and of course, quite a lot of people who want to do that sort of research start waving those sort of numbers around on Capitol Hill in front of senators and Congress people. And this is, of course, quite unpopular. This is Michael Mann, the very noted climate scientist, saying, going back to what I said before, that I prefer climate solutions that involve less rather than more pollution of our atmosphere. Conceptualizing solar geoengineering purely as pollution rather than as something in a way derived from pollution, as Crutzen did. And again, saying basically, I want us to go back to natural. I don't really want to be part of this debate about how to build some sort of hybrid atmosphere or biosphere. A more detailed response from Frank Bierman, who's a professor of global governance at the University of Utrecht, goes in really hard on this report. This proposal is dangerous. Notice the proposal is just for research, but this proposal just for research is dangerous. Solar geoengineering technologies remain speculative, this is true, and assume a level of understanding of the planetary system that does not exist. Now is that true? Does a technology assume a level? I think he's jumping in. He's trying to ascribe to a group of people who he doesn't really identify, actually he does later, who want solar geoengineering, that they are assuming a level of understanding. But he's actually saying the technology has a level. The technology doesn't assume a level of understanding. We know, everyone who looks at this knows, that there are still large uncertainties, and also that the largest uncertainties are not about what the technology would do, but about if and how it would be used by whom. Frank goes on to make this point, which is, as I said, something that many people in the area are very aware of, which is that there's this risk that if you have solar geoengineering talked about seriously, researched, then you will be giving an extra lever to the real covert interests, vested interests, which want to stop mitigation action. And he lists here the Koch brothers, oil producing countries, Wall Street, and that's the great unknowable. It may be that those organisations, emboldened by talk of solar geoengineering, would find that they could push their anti-climate action agenda more harder way. Yes, there you go, in a harder way. I mastered the comparative form. At the same time, it's also worth noting that they've had every opportunity to do this so far. It's not as though solar geoengineering is a new idea. In many ways, the ideas as they're being discussed today are very, very like those ideas of 2006. And by and large, the fossil fuel industry, the Koch brothers, etc., have treated them with an absolute lack of interest. Now, it's possible that this is a bi-stable situation. It's possible that you go from basically denying that climate change is a problem, straight away switching to climate change is a problem and only solar geoengineering is the solution. And I talk about this in my book. I call it the super freak pivot, because it's an idea that you come across in a book called Super Freakonomics, which I don't recommend. Freakonomics is quite a good book. I don't think Super Freakonomics is very good, but that's by the by. But Frank goes from this to saying, in the context of a report about research, just going down quite bluntly to solar geoengineering is wrong, solar geoengineering must be stopped. And so you can see from this that within academic circles, there is really quite hot debate here. Most of the natural scientists who look at these issues probably would quite like to see more solar geoengineering research. That's certainly the finding of an elicitation put out by Harvard, where the biggest solar geoengineering research program currently resides, which found that experts in the field drawn from the IPCC did generally want more spent on researching it. Now, it's also true that they are the sort of people who research it. So that is not an entirely disinterested finding as far as I can see. But it is a finding that there is a serious appetite for more research like this. At the same time, there are very serious voices like Frank, like Michael Mann, like an awful lot of climate action, of people oriented towards climate action, who really don't want to see this at all. They don't want to see it more specifically because they think that it will erode the current progress being made on mitigation, the current insufficient progress being made on mitigation, and also because they dislike the very idea of attempting to govern in a human political way a planet that they would rather see returned to an entirely inhuman self-governance. This point is really nicely put by Andreas Malm in that book edited by Holly that I showed you earlier. Subjectively and objectively, geoengineering is an extreme expression, perhaps the extreme expression of a paradox of capitalist modernity. The structures set up by people are perceived as immune to tinkering, but there is hardly any limit to how natural systems can be manipulated. The nature becomes plastic and contingent. The social becomes set in stone. Very nicely turned phrase, especially that last bit. I think that it overstates, partly because it's actually directed in the context of his essay specifically towards me, but I do think that in general it's somewhat overstated. I don't think that most people talking about solar geoengineering think that natural systems are manipulable without limit, and I don't think they think that systems set up by people are immune to tinkering. But that's the strong version of this claim. And it goes back to this idea, this lovely photo that was used actually to illustrate my original Nature piece, and I've liked it ever since, very clearly gives you this sense of the dystopian. I mean, it's obviously a picture of today, and it illustrates the fact that hazes will reflect away sunshine. But it also, unavoidably to anyone of my generation and probably of younger generations, it's very dystopian. It's actually particularly very Blade Runner. And I was struck, this is Blade Runner 2049, the sequel to Blade Runner. And looking at this, I was struck by the cinematography of the film by Roger Deakins is absolutely gorgeous. But also, this particular shot struck me as being an interesting echo of one of the most famous pictures of the 19th century. So you see the viaduct, you see progress away, you see the mode of transportation that's as modern as the setting can allow. This is basically Turner's Rain, Speed and Steam turned back to front. The reason why this intrigues me is that for me, Rain, Speed and Steam is the emblematic early artwork of what we now call, thanks to Paul Crutzen, the Anthropocene. It is a world in which the motion of the natural and the motion of the artificial are for the first time indistinguishable. It's a world with the unnatural creation of these strong lines, this sense of progress through perspective, and yet at the same time this blurring of the progressive human and the sublime natural. So a great painting. Interesting to draw the comparison with Blade Runner. Maybe I was trying too much, and then I noticed later on in the film that this is exactly what this film, which remember is all about the conflict and the contrast between the natural and the artificial, between the replicant and the human. They're not talking about Turner and the Anthropocene by accident, because there it is on Harrison Ford's wall. There is the Great Western Railway. And so there is the Anthropocene asking us a question in a major popular work of art. What is it that you want? Do you want the world to be mixed up between the human and the natural? Or do you want some sort of distinction? Do you think that it is inherently dystopic to have a world in which the natural and the human are mixed in this way? Or do you think there's something to be hoped for there? And that's the question that Elizabeth Colbert wrestles with in her very fine book, which I recommend to you. It's also a question which I say this is the great Anthropocene artwork of the 19th century. The great, for me, the great Anthropocene artwork of the 21st century was this by Olafur Eliasson, which I imagine many of you, those of you who are in Britain, may have seen. And this was the recreation of an idea of the climate inside the empty coffin of a fossil fuel power station. It was a work of extraordinary scope that really did bring the cosmic indoors, brought the natural and the sublime into a human building, and also put people into that picture. You see these people lying down on the floor. They're looking at themselves in the mirror that forms the ceiling of the artwork, that makes the sun in this artwork whole. And it's very intriguing that a piece of art that might well have been conceived of as apocalyptic, as dystopic, was actually welcomed. It was seen as something in which there was also some sort of sense of wonder. Now, I'm not saying that geoengineering is a primarily aesthetic concern. I'm not saying that the politics around solar geoengineering are not contested and difficult. And I'm not saying that there is not a great deal of research to be done about how, if at all, it might be carried out, instrumentalized in a safe and just and governable way. But I think we should remember that the idea that you can just move away from nature, so move away from the artificial and back to the natural, is one that is very hard to really take into your heart in the 21st century. So solar geoengineering is not in any way a solution to the climate problem, but I think it's a very powerful way of looking at quite how big and telling that problem is. Thanks very much.
Well, thank you very much, Oliver. And we're going to, let's see, blurring of progressive human and sublime natural. There we go. There's a chance to ask just a couple of questions before we move on to our next speaker. And so we're going to see whether or not it works to get the people who've asked the questions to actually verbally ask the questions. So the first up is going to be Christiane, if we can ask, get Christiane to ask her question.
Hello, this work?
Yes, Christiane, go for it.
Hello, so yeah, I'm just going to read it out. So you do actually inject the stratosphere with sulfur, is there any way to remove it again? Should we eventually reach a point where our climate has recovered, so back into the good old days, if you want, before everything has changed through your human hand?
That's an excellent question, Christiane, yes. The reason that you need less sulfur in the stratosphere than is required for the same amount of cooling in down near the ground, the troposphere, is that sulfur stays up in the stratosphere for a much longer time. It gets rained out in days to weeks when it's close to the ground. It stays up for years when it's or about 1 to 1.5 years when it's in the stratosphere, but it does fall out. And so one of the things about solar geoengineering, and we might come onto this in further questions, that worries people is that if you stop doing it, if you stop doing the injection, then the cooling effect will fairly soon decay. And this leads people to worry that you would then unmask all of the warming that you would otherwise be subject to, rather as in Hansen's analysis, the clearing up of pollution at ground level is unmasking more warming. There are various reasons why that is a genuine concern. There are various reasons why I think it's somewhat overplayed sometimes. But yes, sulfur in the stratosphere settles out much more slowly than sulfur in the lower atmosphere, but fairly surely.
Excellent. So the next question is about terminology, and I'm fascinated by the implications of terminology in this, whether it's smog or volcanoes, or whether it's reflecting sunlight or solar radiation management. It makes so much of a difference, in the way that these things are interpreted. But can I ask Paul Knops to ask his question, please?
Hello. Do you hear me now? Because I was looking for the speaker.
Yes, we can hear you.
Thank you. I'm following this discussion for, I think, more than a decade. And I noticed, let's say, 10 years ago, a big discussion between geoengineering. But now you see a clearly split between solar radiation management and carbon dioxide removal. As a physics guy, I would say we're putting quite some CO2 into the atmosphere. Removing it is, for a physics guy, the same order of magnitude, but then just putting a plus and a minus sign. So why do we call carbon dioxide removal geoengineering and not putting a coal-fired power plant back to work geoengineering?
I think, Paul, that it really goes back to Thomas Aquinas.
That's a long way back.
indeed. But the idea of what is the primary purpose of that which you're doing, and although you could now say and should say that no one can be putting carbon dioxide into the atmosphere unaware of that which they're doing, they are doing it in the process of doing something else, whereas the engineer would be taking out of it, would be designing a process for taking it out, and that intention matters. And the other part of your question, which was about why should we talk about solar geoengineering and carbon geoengineering as being related? There is a reason, which is not a great reason, just historically that is how the field grew up. But there's actually, I think, a more profound reason, which is why, although they are technologically remarkably dissimilar, I do think that they bear study at the in the same format. And that is what they have in common is that they decouple climate outcomes from cumulative emitted greenhouse gases. Solar geoengineering does this by changing the incoming radiation. Carbon geoengineering does this by taking carbon that's been emitted out of the atmosphere far faster than it would otherwise have been removed. But either way, they decouple the total cumulative emissions from the climate outcome. And this matters a great deal because it means that they are similar to each other and entirely unlike other forms of action, in that they can deal at whatever point that they're instantiated, if they were to be instantiated, they can deal with stuff that has already been emitted. And emissions reduction, that's what emissions reduction can't do. And so I think it's not that subtle a point, actually. But I do think that it's a good reason why, even though technologically they are, as you say, remarkably different, they are at the same time both ways of doing the same sort of thing. And in fact, they're both similar to the same sort of complaints, because if you think that the prospect of solar geoengineering might lead people to do less mitigation, I assure you that we can also think that the prospect of carbon geoengineering by taking carbon dioxide out of the atmosphere is also likely to convince people to do less mitigation. So they have a lot of formal similarities, even though they are technologically and in terms of Earth system science, incredibly distinct.
Excellent. And one last question before we move on to the next presentation. Robert Chris, could you ask your question, please?
Hi there. Hello. Long time since we've seen each other, quite some years. There you go. Anyway, probably forgotten. I put three questions in here, and it's interesting to see which one has come to the top. So this one is, could you see SRM being marketized, much like the marketization of emissions abatement and current attempts to marketize greenhouse gas removal, and largely being given up to the private sector rather than being undertaken by the state or some super state entity?
I must say, I don't think I can see that. No, but you know, I may just lack the imagination, but I think that this is the sort of thing, it's very, very hard to see how you would charge anyone for it. Because, and I've been involved in some attempts, there's no way that you can in any meaningful way make an equivalence between a ton of carbon dioxide removed and a certain amount of solar geoengineering, not least for the reason that we referred to in Christiane's question at the very beginning. The solar geoengineering cooling isn't permanent. I mean, if it's done properly, the carbon sequestration really is a ton of carbon that was in the atmosphere and is somewhere else. But there's no way to actually guarantee that a solar geoengineering cooling will persist. And so I think there's no real way to commoditize it. And I also think it would freak people the hell out if you even tried. And I just don't see how you could try. And it would also freak the companies out, because one of the things that companies really, really dislike is liability. And the idea that you might be responsible for the whole planet in a court of law would be very freaky to people. And if it's not done in a court of law, then there aren't enforceable contracts, and so you won't be able to make money out of any anyway. So I think there are real issues there, but at the same time, I mean, there are real issues about who will end up doing it, but who will end up planning it and controlling it will, I think, almost certainly be governments. And it's certainly, and if it's not governments, it certainly won't be people doing it for individual profit.
Thank you. I'm just going to ask, there's an anonymous question that quite a lot of people are interested in, and I'm just going to have a really quick answer from you, Oliver, on this one. Will injecting sulfur into the stratosphere not lead to an increase in acid rain and breathing difficulties?
It's a very good question. And this is, again, part of the brilliance of the context in which Paul Crutzen set up the original question, which was effectively, if you are removing sulfur from the lower atmosphere, you can put a little bit into the stratosphere, and because it's the lower atmosphere that you breathe. And so the amount that you would put up into the stratosphere would be about 2% of the amount that you're putting into the lower atmosphere at the moment. And so its harm would be much less than what is already being done. Now, of course, that's still harm. And if you actually do manage to clean up all the coal plants, God willing, then, you know, it would become one of the larger sources of sulfur in the atmosphere, still not as large as the amount produced by plankton, but it would still be large. But the other great thing about it, from this point of view, is that the reason that most sulfur particles in the lower atmosphere kill people is that they are produced close to where people are. People are fairly concentrated on the Earth, and the stratosphere is fairly, is absolutely and completely ubiquitous. And so it's not only that this amount of sulfur would be about 2% of current emissions of sulfur, it's also that it will settle out evenly around the world rather than, you know, all in cities in China. And so calculations have been done, and the although you would say that some of the sulfur burden, thus some of the mortality burden would be due to this, it would be absolutely tiny compared to the amount of people who currently die because of air pollution emitted in the old-fashioned way.
Well, thank you very much, Oliver. And Oliver is going to come back at the end for a Q&A discussion. But now is the time to hand the floor over to Holly Buck, who's going to give the next presentation. So, Holly.
Thanks so much. It's very tough to follow such a rich presentation, especially in the evening hours when our brains may be full from the events of the day as well. But this is an important question. Should society try to remove a trillion tons of carbon from the atmosphere? I've tried to avoid using the word we for Oliver's sake and everybody else's. But I mean, there is this question that's been circulating, especially among the entrepreneurial community, positing this as a goal. So let's talk about it. Here's some of the big questions. I'm going to try to cover all of these, but of course, in a pretty shallow way, given the time. Why is everybody even talking about carbon removal? How much carbon removal are we talking about? How would we go about removing whatever amount that is? Who could actually do it? And is all this just going to delay cutting emissions? So in terms of this first question, you know, carbon removal is implicit in net zero. I'm sure you've heard about all the net zero announcements of the past year and beyond. The idea here is that there's some amount of positive emissions balanced by some amount of negative emissions. And this is a plot from Glenn Peters. You could find similar plots around, you know, these emission pathways, which are generated using integrated assessment models. But basically what you can see here, this is at mid-century, there's an inflection point, right? Right now, there's a lot of emissions from different sectors near the end of the century. There's much more removed than are emitted. And we'll talk more about this in a minute. So how do you define how many emissions are left over? In a modeling sense, it's something as, you know, whatever the model says is too expensive to get rid of. If you're a city, and many cities have net zero targets, it might be those emissions where the city has limited options to eliminate or reduce further. So I pulled this from San Francisco's climate plan. A lot of cities have or are in the process of figuring out their roadmaps to net zero. As our countries and companies, now that we've said, okay, net zero, we have to figure out how many emissions are left over, how many we'll need to compensate for them. And so San Francisco thinks it may have to deal with 12% of business as usual emissions that can't be eliminated. And I can tell you that that's actually really good. And their emissions are coming from, you know, largely from transportation, also some from waste and buildings. But if you're a company, you might define these leftover or residual emissions in terms of your value chain. In practice, entities can self-define and claim various amounts of residual emissions that are just too hard for them to get rid of. And so carbon removal plays a few different roles in net zero scenarios. One is this compensating for some amount of continued CO2 emissions. But it's also compensating for emissions of other greenhouse gases, and then possibly compensating for historical emissions. So if there's an overshoot of these targets later in the century, removing that extra carbon. And so here's a report from the world, the Royal Society, where you guys are, about greenhouse gas removal, another 2-degree scenario. I mean, you'll notice a few things about this figure. One is that emissions decline rapidly starting right now. And then by the end of the century, the world is removing more than's being emitted. But a lot of these continued emissions are other greenhouse gases like nitrous oxide, like methane, et cetera. And that this negative emissions portion, the green part, that begins around 2030, which means that it's infrastructure that's being planned and permitted and financed and technologies that are being developed right now. So this is what I think really changed the conversation about carbon removal, is this special report from the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change in 2018, where they looked at the 1.5 degree target set out in the Paris Agreement. And they note that, you know, I mean, this is the exact language, the pathways that limit warming to 1.5 with limited or no overshoot project the use of carbon removal on the order of 100 to 1,000 gigatons, a gigaton being a billion tons, over this century, and that it would be used to compensate for these residual emissions and achieve net negative to return global warming to 1.5 following a peak. So those different use cases. And so here you're probably wondering, okay, why do we have these leftover emissions? Can't we just get rid of them all? And I'm kind of thinking that maybe the conventional wisdom on this is changing a bit, because people are getting more ambitious about decarbonizing electricity fully and figuring out solutions around load-bearing electricity. And people are also seem to be getting more ambitious about industrial emissions and using CCS with industry. But generally, most people will say there will be some residual emissions. And so which, you know, this is a picture of the emissions we have now, a quarter from industry, it's probably some residual emissions there because of industrial processes that require high temperature. Transportation is one where generally there's some consensus that there would be residual emissions from long-haul aviation, possibly shipping. Agriculture, a really big one, especially nitrous oxide emissions from fertilizer. So those are some of the things. But I mean, so far there's not a real consensus or a political discussion, although I imagine this is coming very soon. And I wanted to point you all to this resource, the CDR Primer, which is an open source, very nicely designed project by many, many scientists to look at this. And they have an analysis of a more ambitious scenario for residual emissions, where they found that, okay, what might be left over if you did fully decarbonize electricity, you'd have between 1.5 to 3.1 gigatons left over, mostly agricultural nitrous oxide and some from transportation. And so that's very different than this image I showed you a few slides ago, which I'll go back to. This scenario and many that are used in these types of analysis picture, you know, between 10 and 20 gigatons near the end of the century. There's a very big difference between, you know, one or two or three and 10 or 20. And we'll talk about why that is in a second. But let's talk about the how question, right? There's a lot of different methods being discussed. People categorize these sometimes as, you know, buckets of natural and engineered. I think that's just kind of the same old nature society binary. But you can talk about it that way. People do. I think also it's useful to point towards, you know, short-term storage and long-term storage, because those have different implications. But I'm going to talk about a couple of these techniques in very little detail. Planting trees, you've probably heard about this. In the US, we had some legislation discussed about a Trillion Trees Act. Greenpeace identified this as tree washing. And there's a lot of discussion about you know, the role of afforestation, the land demands for it that we could talk about. Soil carbon is another thing that people are excited about because there's been a big loss of soil carbon. So there's a big opportunity to put some back into the soil. People are thinking about, you know, plants with longer roots that can store more, engineering plants for soil carbon storage. So, you know, these things are moving along to some degree. Regenerative agriculture, obviously, no-till, cover crops, et cetera. The challenge with some of these natural climate solutions, I mean, one is land limitations for afforestation. Another is that these sinks will plateau over time. So you can store carbon for some decades, but then those sinks will be filled up and they can't keep on going indefinitely throughout the end of the century into the next. Then you have to hold the carbon there. So if the farming practices switch again, or if there's a wildfire, you lose the carbon. So basically, I mean, I'm very sorry to say this, I wish it wasn't true, but there's just no way for nature to take up this huge amount of carbon that's already been put there. People always ask, why can't we just rely on nature? I mean, this is why. And so, you know, you'll have things like Shell put out some scenarios that talked about CO2 removal using nature in this 1.5 scenario they came out with pretty recently. They note that it requires major reforestation, some 700 million hectares of land, an area approaching that of Brazil. And then Greta rightfully called that out. But Shell's interest here is also having an effective policy framework. They're calling for governance of both natural carbon sinks and man-made carbon sinks. So they know the rules of the game going forward. Bioenergy with carbon capture and storage. Here's another concept that can be viewed as a hybrid. Have biomass, transport it to a facility where it can be combusted and the CO2 is separated out and injected underground. And so there's some discussion of figuring out how to do this with agricultural waste, for example. There's some good opportunities with using waste in this way. But this has also been much criticized because people are remembering all the bad experiences with bioenergy to date and, you know, thinking about large scale land acquisitions for bioenergy if this was targeted as a good approach. Something receiving more and more attention, in my view, is direct air capture. So giant machines, well, I mean, machines, depending on where you put them, how giant they are, there's a few different designs, but machines that would take carbon out of the atmosphere. Some of the limitations to this right now is the cost, but analysts are looking at different curves and anticipating that the costs may come down. The energy to run these processes of removing carbon right now is very high. So the large scale use of this is imagining that there's abundant low carbon energy. And then once you have the CO2, it still needs to be transported and injected underground. But you'll see some companies working in this space. Main point is that, you know, right now a typical carbon capture and storage facility, an industrial one, there's probably 25 or so existing, but some more planned. So those are about 1 million tons per year, give or take. So you would need, you know, thousands of these if you're going to draw down these 10 gigatons of CO2 by the end of the century. If you're thinking about 1 or 2 gigatons, that's still somewhat more doable, but it's still, you know, but we're talking about an infrastructure roughly on the scale of the existing fossil fuel industry, maybe larger for the purpose of putting carbon back underground. Some people might say running the fossil fuel industry in reverse. Though I do want to mention that even decarbonization without thinking about this carbon removal stuff requires building a whole bunch of stuff right away that's going to take up a lot of land. These figures are from, you know, an analysis of the US, but I mean, this is similar in other places. Thinking about wind farms, basically around the area of about 6 states, solar farms also taking up a fair amount of land, lots of new transmission lines. So either way, we have a bunch of big engineering projects ahead that may have impacts on land and biodiversity, especially depending on how intelligently we go about them. So that brings up the question, okay, who's going to build all this stuff? Who has the money to and the expertise to? Who has the motivation to? The first obvious candidate is the fossil fuel industry, since they're already involved with transporting, injecting CO2. Aramco, the world's biggest company by market cap, has, you know, this concept of reduce, recycle, reuse, remove carbon. There's companies that are pushing towards, you know, differentiated lower carbon fuels. So being able to market a fuel as having a lower carbon footprint, there's different ways of doing that in oil and in gas. But here, for example, one of the ways that's being discussed is enhanced oil recovery. So that's using captured CO2 injected into depleted wells to extract more oil from them. This is something that's been going on at least since the 1970s. In the US, there's a few thousand miles of pipelines for this. Right now, carbon is actually extracted from natural deposits. So oil companies are naturally thinking, well, what if we took it from the air and if the government supported that? That could be cheaper, right? So really, I think that climate politics needs to address the fact that lower carbon fossil fuels will probably become available in the next decade. What does that do to our tactics and arguments? So what about billionaires? You know, Elon got some attention for sponsoring this carbon removal contest, probably kind of pocket change for him. But there's a big question about the role of the tech industry more broadly, because few companies have, you know, they've set these net zero targets and they have the capital and interest to develop carbon removal. So Microsoft wants to be carbon negative by 2030. They want to also remove their historical emissions going back to when they were founded. They put together this $1 billion climate innovation fund, and they're partnering with bioenergy and carbon capture and storage facilities, but also thinking about how to catalyze this whole industry. Same thing with Shopify. They have a fund too, much smaller, it's $5 million a year or so. But they say, you know, we need to reverse climate change. Commerce and entrepreneurship can only thrive in the long term. So, I mean, maybe what we're seeing here is other parts of capital that want to stand up to fossil fuels, maybe making a stand here. I don't know. We can talk about that. But their idea is to kickstart the market, right? So these big purchasers could get things going. And they're having a hard time, I think, figuring out what to invest in because there just aren't that many options for carbon removal on the market. Stripe is another company that's thinking about this, that's investing in it. And also, you know, thinking about an interface for helping consumers participate in it. So back to some of these questions. You know, people say, okay, why don't we wait until we have mitigation underway before we think about removing carbon? Obviously, we should be focusing everything we have on mitigation, given what we know about how steep these reductions have to be. On the other hand, you could say, well, this infrastructure takes time to plan and build. It's heavy capital, big projects, and the technologies need to be improved. And there's a case, even if emissions do get slashed really quickly, we would still want this technology to continue to remove some of the carbon that's already up there. Yet, rushing to build things could lock in the wrong technologies. That's a risk too. My view personally is that I think people and climate advocates, really everybody should be engaging with this now, because it would be nice to see it developed in the public interest as a public project. The government's obviously, you know, even bigger than the fossil fuel industry or the tech industry in terms of who can kick this off. And the risk of waiting to engage with it means that it could be developed thinking of the needs of big companies first and public second. But, you know, on this question of is all this just going to delay cutting emissions, I don't know. There's a lot of different arguments that it would or it won't. I think that what we need to be asking is not just how do we get to net zero emissions, but what do we do with the fossil fuel industry? A lot of climate policy and politics is focused on emissions. I think if we focus on production and a planned phase out of fossil fuels, that would be the way to avoid the mitigation deterrence considerations with both carbon removal and solar geoengineering. And if you want to think more about that, I encourage looking at this carbon take back proposal, one of many, about how to go about removing carbon. So I'll leave it there. I look forward to our discussion.
Well, thank you very much, Holly. So we're going to have a few questions for you, Holly, and then we'll bring Oliver back in and have a debate between the two of you and more, you know, opportunity to ask more questions to both of you. But I'm going to do as I did before and pick out some of the questions, although it's got more complicated now because some of them are still lurking around that were relevant to Oliver. So I'll do the best I can. And please do upvote questions that you like the look of or add new questions to the Q&A. But first up, I'm going to ask Andrew Harmsworth. He's got a question about moral hazard. Andrew.
Hello, yes, thank you. Let me, you can't unmute me there so, because I haven't got a microphone on. So the moral question is one, Oliver quoted someone who said that solar geoengineering must be stopped. Is it irresponsible to not undertake research? In other words, is the absence of knowledge more ignorance?
Well, I mean, I have also thought a bunch about solar geoengineering, and I'm in favor of doing research on it, even though I understand all of the very good considerations and risks. We just had a pretty good discussion about the National Academy's study before this call with David Keith and Chris Field and a few other experts about it. I think that we need to know what the risks and the negative impacts could be, and the best way to do that is to have a publicly funded program with public oversight.
Another question for you, Holly, that's an anonymous one, so I'll just ask it. Should carbon dioxide removal really be a suggestion for anything other than removing historical emissions? Should we not focus on zero emission technologies to create a fully sustainable future?
Yeah, that's a great question. I mean, I think what we need to do is specify residual emissions for each sector so that we don't get people claiming like they really need this extra 10 gigatons if we have knowledge that it's technically possible to do 1.5 left over. Then, you know, that should be our target. And, you know, I do think that, so I know people who would say that, okay, if we can't get to zero emissions from aviation, we should just stop flying. I disagree with that perspective because, you know, for all of this to work, we need, good support from a broad section of society. So some visions of decarbonization are probably not compatible with democracy, and I think democracy is really important. So some kind of consensus residual emissions we can live with, 1.5 to 3 sounds pretty good to me, and it would be honestly a miracle if we managed to get there. But this is all in the time span of this century too. So, I mean, I do encourage thinking beyond this century about what the long-term goals are. And I think that probably we could figure out some zero carbon aviation solution in the future.
And there's another anonymous one here. Given carbon removal is mostly embraced by fossil fuel companies and billionaires, should that not be a massive red flag about the underlying intentions about delaying decarbonization?
No. I don't think so, because one problem is that most people have never heard about it. So just because the people who have heard about it are the ones that are for it doesn't mean, like, I don't know. I mean, you know, the pharmaceutical industry is plenty corrupt, but like, I'm going to get a vaccine, you know? I mean, you can't just link the interests with the inherent worth of the product.
Okay, now I'm going to bring Oliver back in to have a discussion between the both of you. And so again, please do keep adding your questions, and I will start navigating the increasingly complex set of questions that are here. If you put your questions in anonymously, I'll try and ask them on your behalf. If you put your name in as well, then I will invite you to ask your questions yourselves. I'm going to start with one of the top anonymous ones here that's to both of you, and it says, what's your personal view on the likely outcomes we'll see in the next 5, 10 or 20 years? I might mean this primarily in terms of the adoption of geoengineering policies nationally and internationally, or other climate crisis prevention strategies. And the questioner asks, should I be worried or optimistic or something else entirely? So I don't know who wants to go first. Oliver, why don't you go first? Your personal view on the likely outcomes.
It's slightly hard, Anonymous, because I don't know what worries you most. and so what happens with geoengineering approaches is going to worry some people. Whatever happens, there will be a group of people who get worried. I know enough about this and look at enough of the different possibilities that I honestly don't know what I expect. My tendency is to think that opportunities for good will be lost because this won't move in the way that would maximize, that would do most to reduce harm. What actually happens with carbon geoengineering in the next 5, 10 or 20 years matters, but not in that time scale. As Holly was saying, you have to plan the technology now in order to be able to use it later. But there's no way that sort of like a significant, that the amount of carbon removal in the next 20 years is going to be significantly move the dial compared to the amount of emissions reduction. Solar geoengineering has got this issue that it's much prompter. I think that you could see, in his magnificent recent novel, Ministry for the Future, which I highly commend to all of you, Kim Stanley Robinson imagines India mounting a stratospheric aerosol injection program after a particularly horrible adverse climate event. But is that the good version? I mean, is that the good version or the bad version? I mean, does that make you more or less worried? I honestly don't know how you should feel about that, because I honestly don't know how I feel about that. But I do want to know a lot more about what can be done. I do want to have people having discussions like this so that these very basic questions to me about the artificial and the natural get aired and exercised.
Holly, do you want to add anything there?
I mean, what I'm concerned about, I'm concerned about the media ecosystem in which we discuss these things. And I'm concerned that the climate politics of the next decade, one, I'm concerned we might have a disenchantment with renewables that is, in terms of them not being deployed fast enough. I'm concerned that we'll also have this unproductive public debate where some people are focused on, you know, things like everybody going vegan or stopping flying, which are a distraction from things like getting a few companies to cut industrial emissions, which could make a huge, huge difference. And so, you know, we get stuck in this politics of restriction. And the reason I'm concerned about that is just watching how everything unfolded with the response to COVID. And now we have a segment of society that thinks that COVID lockdowns were a warm up for climate lockdowns. And so I'm watching that discussion evolve mostly on the right, on the internet. And, you know, anything that's a behavioral restriction is going to be seen as evidence of that from this other faction. And it could just lead to a very stuck politics. And after we have that stuck politics for some time, then we could have solar and geoengineering introduced. So yeah, I'm pretty worried. I think everybody should be worried, but I'm also worried about war and autonomous robots and other things. So there's plenty to be worried about.
I'm going to ask one of the questions from the floor, and I'm going to ask Remy Boutet to ask his question. Remy. Is Remy still there? Can we unmute Remy? Yes, no? I'll ask his question for him. It's about solar radiation management. And it says, research projects have a around about a 15 year lead lag. And the National Academy of Sciences report says we should be spending, as you said, Oliver, around $100 to $200 million over 5 years. And we're spending about $10 million per year worldwide. We are hence deciding to not know what we should by the time we may need this. These amounts are really puny. What needs to change to get us back on track? Oliver, what do you think?
I think it's really, really hard. You can't get back. I mean, as I think many of us are feeling at this point in the lockdown, you can't get back the time you lost. I would wish that that there had been more serious research on this after on solar after Paul's article. There was more, but it's a hugely difficult problem. It's not necessarily the case, I think, that you can't make real progress with 200 what would it be, $40 million a year? And there's a certain amount of a problem with capacity. I'm not sure you could spend $40 million a year very usefully in solar geoengineering next year. But you've got to build up the capacity. And I think that if you can spend at that level, you can build up quite a lot of capacity. Would that we weren't, yes, if people had had different sorts of foresight in the 1970s and 80s, it might be a very different world, but we are where we are, Remy.
Next question I'm going to ask you, Hugh Hunt, this comes back to the face-off between solar radiation management and carbon dioxide removal. Hugh, off you go.
Well, I guess we're there's not a lot of time left to scale stuff up to have a meaningful impact. So CDR versus SRM, which are we going to back to get us there quickest?
Okay, having said I didn't want to go into a whole smackdown thing, I want to reject the premise. One of the important things about, and I don't like the term SRM either, one of the important things about solar geoengineering, as I said, is that you have to do it for a long time in order until you can sort of like phase it out when you can match yourself to the climate level that is then appropriate. I've explained that incredibly badly. Let me put that a different way. You want to eventually have a world without SRM, which means you want to have solar geoengineering, which means you want to have a world with a climate at the level that you want. And that's in itself very difficult because different countries have legitimately different views about how much what the climate should be. But that means that if you undertake solar geoengineering, so you have a cooler climate than the greenhouse gases would otherwise give you, you have to be thinking about getting rid of the greenhouse gases whose effects you're masking over a relatively short, say, century period of time, rather than the thousands of years that these things take naturally. So to do solar geoengineering without carbon geoengineering being developed would, I think, be the heart of silliness. That said, it's undeniably the case that solar geoengineering can make a real impact in terms of fractions of a degree Celsius in years, and carbon geoengineering really can't do that.
Holly, what's your thoughts?
Yeah, I mean, I think we need to be thinking about both and researching both. And I think that the National Academies report, with the emphasis it had, the level of funding it had, was really appropriate to the problem in the time. I wouldn't actually want to see more money than that going into this right now. I think they did a good job, but remember that 100 to 200 million over 5 years is not very much in the context of science funding, much less in the context of government budgets. So, I mean, what I'd like to see is shifting the defense budget into decarbonization broadly, but, you know.
I just want to go back to my answer to Hugh. I've been thinking about stronger. Anyone who talks about doing solar geoengineering without also talking about doing carbon geoengineering is a knave, and you should avoid them.
Agreed.
Excellent. I'm going to go to the audience again, and Kate MG, would you like to ask your question, Kate?
Hi, can I be heard?
Yes, you can.
Oh, great. Okay, marvelous. Thanks so much for a really amazing presentation, both of you. I guess my question, particularly it sprung up, Holly, during your time, was that there are lots of nations that, if we think about these great infrastructure proposals, it amounts to pretty much taking our garbage and burying it in the forest, which is what, you know, we did before we had municipal garbage collection programs. But a lot of countries don't have land that they can bury carbon in like that. So at what point will we start to think globally about the problems we're creating and how we're solving them? So this might be a global court, for instance.
So thinking about, okay, I see the part about the global court. Yeah, but what I'd like to see is a global discussion about phasing out fossil fuel production. And some people have suggested this, like a fossil fuel non-proliferation treaty. There's been papers and commentary about this, but you know, if we want to think about net zero, we need to think about what are the levels of residual emission and who is responsible for the carbon removal. And it's very true that not everybody has the capacity to remove carbon or decarbonize in the same way. So a lot of people are saying, you know, net zero is terrible, forget net zero. And I understand that, but the other thing about net zero is because it's this balancing principle, you can also imagine a version of net zero that's used for equity. Say if you have a country that doesn't have the capacity to remove carbon, that could use some fossil fuels to develop a bit more before phasing out. You can imagine a country like the United States, which already has a ridiculous amount that it's put in the air. They could say, hey, let's remove the carbon here in the US where we have a lot of good geology for storing carbon. And that buys time for this other country to figure out how to eliminate their emissions. Now, is that very likely? Of course, that's not very likely. But what I'm saying is that, you know, we need to think about what progressive uses we might have for some of these technologies rather than just rejecting them because they're technologies or because they're currently held in the hands of the fossil fuel industry. Because if we have the capacity to remove carbon from the atmosphere, and more we do, what kind of people are we if we just decide not to do it? That's what I'm grappling with.
Yeah, and I can see that. I guess my question is really, it comes down to climate justice issues, you know? So I just think that we've got responsibility as a planet and that we're now seeing going through the courts, things on technology that should have been dealt with, decades ago relating to the internet. And I'm just wondering if, whether it's Cambridge Zero or if another group would actually start doing sort of a global view on these justice issues across time and place.
MJ, I think that part of my feeling about that would be that if, I know this is a big if the international community can get somewhere on loss and damage in the UNFCCC negotiations, I think dealing with historic emissions of less developed countries would be a very good way of handling loss and damage questions. I think that I think it's a way to mutualize them, and I think that there's a real worry among developed nations that they would just be on the hook for everything if loss and damage became a reality. But if loss and damage payments had to be made through carbon dioxide reduction, I think that might be a way forward for both parties. I'm not sure that that's the best way to handle loss and damage, but loss and damage is going to be increasingly a big issue in global climate politics because of the justice issues that you rightly highlight. And so maybe using carbon dioxide removal by the rich world as a way of acting for the poor world, that might be a way forward, but it's very hard to say.
I'm going to go back to the floor, and there's a question from Keshav.
Sorry, you had trouble unmuting here. Yes, hello. My question was, or a comment really, was about the fact that the problem with geoengineering is human nature. When you have a choice between two paths, you prefer the path of least resistance. And if geoengineering is that path, then I think that's what people would be attracted to. The problem with this at some level is hubris, because there's unintended consequences, and every technology seems to have one. It's not the intention, as you said. Aquinas said, intentions matter, but what about unintended consequences?
As you say, Chef, that is a comment. Yes, I don't think human nature is immutable. I think humans behave in different ways in different societies and at different times. I think that things which are seen as immutable aspects of what it is to be human, for instance, that women should have less autonomy than men, can be changed. And I think that's a great thing about humankind, but I don't imagine for a moment that it's easy. It's not that I think I tend to be more more Marxist about this. I tend to see the structural issues more than these issues about, you know, what it is to have, for there to be a human nature. But unintended consequences, yes. Otherwise, yes, unintended consequences, there will be unintended consequences. And you should try and understand them, even if they're unintended. But that doesn't mean that you should that you should necessarily not do anything because of the possibility of unintended consequences. But if your point was to just remind us that this is very complicated and probably going to end up messily and in many ways unsatisfactorily, I assure you, I don't need reminding of that. That's very much how I see the world going forward.
Okay. Anything to add there, Holly?
Not really.
I'm going to ask a question, one of the anonymous questions that's pretty popular. Do you think a carbon tax will be an effective solution to help encourage research into carbon capture, as well as decreasing emissions, without simply negatively impacting the quality of life of the poorest?
I think that some form of a price on carbon is going to be a part of things going forward. And there's increasing amount of jurisdictions living under some form of a carbon price. I think that, you know, my view is that we need to focus more on production and plan phase out too. So I think I would like to couple those types of things with, you know, permissions to extract or something like a carbon take back requirement, which links production with carbon removal. I think that that would be the best way forward personally.
I think the problem is that carbon taxes don't actually encourage speculative research. I think carbon taxes are really useful for managing trade-offs between existing technologies. I mean, the carbon prices have done great work in Europe in moving people from coal to gas, and I include Britain in Europe there. But I think that in order to make a big research commitment with an eye to deployment, you're looking on 20, 30 year timescales. And I think that experience with things like the fuel price escalator in the UK suggests you cannot trust a political system to keep a carbon tax at a predictable level for 10, 20, 30, 40 years. And so though I understand, and my economist friends at The Economist are very keen on the idea that this is a very rational way to do things, I think the political economy is rather hard, because I think many people feel that, you know, a carbon tax that the American Petroleum Institute is happy with, a carbon price that they're happy with, is a carbon price that almost by definition is insufficient, because if the API can live with it, then the rest of us can't.
And can I ask Iris de Vries to ask her question?
Yes, can you hear me now?
Yes.
I can just read it up. The most evident and, in my opinion, also important point that I hear in both of your talks, and that I think you can also see in most of the serious papers or coverage of these subjects, is that we need all efforts. We need mitigation, carbon dioxide removal, solar geoengineering, and adaptation also simultaneously. And also all these efforts serve the same goal, which is reducing or ideally eliminating the adverse effects of climate change. But still, it seems like there are advocates of these different efforts. I mean, you can already see it in the title of this event, I guess. And I was wondering what you would think would be needed to get rid of this sort of competition between these different lines of combating climate change and work together instead on reaching the same goal.
I mean, my answer to this is ambitious, but no less ambitious than any of the stuff we've been discussing. I think that the tendency to pit things against each other is in part, and in good part, a product of the political economy of the platforms we're using to exchange ideas, which have a business model that's advertising driven, designed to maximize time on site. Algorithms have figured out that, you know, these kind of polarizations get more clicks, etc. And so we have these binaries all the time, So I think that in order to actually get to a better discussion of this, we need to break up big tech companies and build a public infrastructure for the internet.
I've just realized I've lost this question. It was on my screen and my screen's jumped around, but it was a don't we need all of it? And I think many people who see this purely through a rational best practice lens would say yes. And it's noticeable that I know of no one in the solar geoengineering research camp who doesn't think that it's also necessary to look at carbon removal, and it's also absolutely vital to do emissions reduction. It is really interesting that strong advocates of emissions reduction do not reciprocate in this. So you see someone like Michael Mann, whose tweet I showed in my talk, saying that we have all the technologies needed to do everything that we need to do, and so we should just get on and do it. And the only reason why that doesn't happen is because of the evil power of the oil companies. And while I believe in the evil power of the oil companies, I really don't think that's the only reason things don't happen. And I think that to say that because it can be done entirely, because it can be done entirely by emissions reduction, we don't need anything else, close quotes, is just not to be looking at the, certainly at the tail probabilities, but I think at the core probabilities very seriously. I don't think emissions reduction on its own is going to get your world below 2 degrees.
It's sort of amazing that we haven't mentioned this already, and we've been now discussing for more than an hour. But the next question that I'm going to ask the audience, that's been raised by the audience, that I'm going to ask, raises another important question associated with all of this. So Nicole Brummer, can you ask your question, please?
Hello.
Hi.
Which question? I had two.
Oh, about ocean acidification.
Yes. Okay. So that's one obvious thing. You've been talking about the atmosphere, but there's also the ocean that acidifies, and the acidity kind of, maybe in the deep ocean, it doesn't matter because it's so deep and so large, but in the more shallow regions, it could actually affect the environment. So shouldn't we also do something about that? And then I don't see anything else than enhanced weathering. So what do you think about that?
So how are we going to solve ocean acidification?
I think I don't want to come over spending the whole evening talking about the late great Paul Crutzen, but he was great and is unfortunately late. And this is another part of his 2006 paper, which I think is really interesting, in that one of the ways in which he gave climate scientists, as it were, license to talk about solar geoengineering was by pointing out that ocean acidification is a really big issue. And it means that even if you're doing solar geoengineering in order to address global average temperature, you have to do something about carbon dioxide emission anyway because of ocean acidification. And I think that still holds. I mean, people often say, but solar geoengineering doesn't do anything about ocean acidification, to which the answer is no, that's why you need to do carbon dioxide, why you need to do emissions reduction and possibly carbon dioxide removal. It's not like no one's trying to hide anything here. Greatly increasing the carbon dioxide level in the atmosphere leads to more carbon dioxide in the oceans, and that is a dangerous thing for a number of ecosystems. I don't have myself a particularly theorized view on enhanced weathering, but it's possible that Holly does.
I don't really have a very scientifically informed view, but I agree that I think we should be looking into the options about it. I'm a social scientist, so anything I would say about ocean chemistry would probably not be the best thing.
Do you want to, Holly, I see one of the other questions that has been asked in the chat is asking you to say a little bit more about your book that's coming out later this year. Do you want to just tell us what it's called and a little bit about what it's about?
Yeah, it's called Ending Fossil Fuels, Why Net Zero is Not Enough, which is why I keep talking about focusing on production, because that's on my mind a lot. Net zero, if we reached it, I think would be really impressive. But we also know from looking at, you know, the unburnable carbon studies about what's locked into our infrastructure that we have to phase out existing facilities, existing production. But, you know, you can't just wave a magic wand and make fossil fuels disappear. You can cancel them discursively online, but there's still the basis of 80% of the energy we use. So I try to get into different ways of looking at the problem of phase out, different policies that could be used. It's very challenging because some places, I think that the US and the UK could manage to phase out coal and oil, possibly even gas, but it's a global situation. There's geopolitical challenges, there's development challenges. So try to dive into that and you can be the judge of how well it works.
And the book's out in the autumn, is that right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Right, let's go back to the audience questions. Nick Rees, you have a question.
Hello, can you hear me?
We can, yes.
Hi, I was just asking that if we don't implement a decent research program into, say, the geoengineering, and we miss the 2050 target for net zero emissions, do we open ourselves for sort of unilateral attempts at geoengineering? Is this a risk that is viable?
I don't know if it's viable, but it's certainly a risk. Yeah, absolutely. It's one of the things, it's to me one of the most important things about thinking seriously about solar geoengineering is that if you think there's a chance you should think seriously about it at any point, you should think seriously about it now. Because there's a point which he would not agree with my interpretation of his point, but Stephen Gardner, a philosopher at the University of Washington, makes an argument about arming the future. And if you tell the argument about eroding away at emissions reductions is that if people think about solar geoengineering, they won't take emissions reductions so seriously. It's not clear at all at what point that becomes more or less problematic. I would say that the mere fact that people talk about solar geoengineering has some effect along those lines. And if you do that, if you talk about solar engineering in a way that erodes mitigation without actually also trying to reduce the risks of solar geoengineering by at least providing people with a more informed view of it, then I think you're being doubly unfair to the subsequent generations. And I think it's a very serious issue. So saying, oh, we should think about geoengineering only for use after a particular catastrophe or only if nothing else works, seems to me to be heightening the moral hazard rather than, as it might sound, being sort of like responsible and reasonable. If you think there are issues about solar geoengineering possibly being necessary is the wrong word, but possibly being an achievable way of reducing harm, then there's a certain onus on you to look at it now, not to wait till later.
I'm going to follow up with a question again from the audience that relates to fairness. I don't have your full name. I just have AF20, but AF20, would you like to ask your question?
Hello, I'm AF20. I'm Mark. Thank you very much for your talks, and I wish at one time I'd been able to introduce both Thomas Aquinas and Blade Runner into one of my lectures. The question is whether there are any projections as to the differential effect of what you are proposing, geoengineering-wise, on lower-income versus higher-income countries, leaving aside the overall impact of reducing global warming. Would there be any other differential impact?
Any thoughts on that differential impact between different countries of these? So if we went down the route of any of these geoengineering solutions, are they likely, is there a danger that some countries will be more adversely affected than others?
I mean, there's different things that people look at, temperature, but also precipitation, also crop production. So you would have want to add to that list and do that analysis for all these different parameters.
Well, yeah, I think that, I mean, there is the question that any amount of, I mean, this is a complicated question. Well, they're all complicated, but I think this has a fairly complicated answer. You can't set the amount of, different amounts of solar geoengineering will have different effects in different places if we just assume that for the moment that it's going to be a global process. But no solar geoengineering program can guarantee how much solar geoengineering there will be, because if you do less than some places would like, then it's not difficult for those places to add to the solar geoengineering, to add to the thin smog in the high sky. And so it's not possible for an individual group of countries partaking in solar geoengineering to necessarily say how much of it they will get. And Marty Weitzman, and also the late great Marty Weitzman, talked about this in terms of being the free driver problem, that if solar geoengineering starts and there's suddenly going to be a sort of like moral activation value before you can get to solar geoengineering starting, if it starts, you will get the largest amount of solar geoengineering that a country which thinks it can act with impunity is willing to impose. And so there's a real problem with ideas of that you can set the amount of solar geoengineering you get. And so that would depend on, and so the answer to your question would be whether the country of impunity, as it were, was acting on behalf of or as part of a tropical group of countries, an extratropical group of countries, or a temperate group of countries. I think it's fairly clear that if the temperate north knew how to do this in a way that would be best for the temperate north, the way that world history would suggest to you that the temperate north would do it the way that was best for the temperate north, because it's done everything else that way. Going into Holly's side of the story just slightly, there's a real worry that if you go strongly on biological systems for drawing down carbon, again, historically, the global north does things with the biological systems of the tropics and exotropics rather than its own biological systems. So, you know, if you're going to do plantation agriculture in order to feed Beck's power stations, the way to bet, whether you're thinking just in terms of political history or in terms of where land prices are lower, is that it will be large tracts of the global south that will get turned into plantations, not Cambridge.
Oliver, you mentioned in your start of your presentation that this topic is especially topical right at the moment, in part because of the National Academies of Science report that came out just yesterday, but also because of there's been a proposed experiment of relevance to all of this in Sweden. I wonder whether either of you would like to comment on your thoughts. Well, maybe you could explain to everyone what that experiment is or is and isn't, and whether what your thoughts on whether it should go ahead or not are. Do you want to go first, Oliver, since it's your...
Okay. I should preface this by saying that the principal investigator on ScopeX, Fred Koch, is a man that I like and respect a lot. And I'm also an occasional co-author with and friend of his boss, David Keith, both parts of the Harvard School of Engineering. So you could say that I have an interest here, but I think that an awful lot of silliness has been talked about ScopeX. People, it's an extremely small experiment designed to work out whether it's possible to look at what aerosols do in the stratosphere, not to make any climate alteration. It's trivial by the amount of particles that everyday aviation puts into the atmosphere, even now with aviation a lot less. I mean, you know, it's in the sort of like 10 to the minus 9 sort of area here. It's really, really small. If you actually want to understand solar geoengineering, one of the problems that people point to is at the moment it's mostly done in models, and that forces you into particular ways of thinking and particular ways of addressing the world and into accepting the implicit and sometimes explicit assumptions of the models. And there's a whole lot of reasons why people are worried about decisions that are made entirely on the basis of modeling. And so finding out stuff about the real world is a good idea, and it also heightens the issue, heightens the cause for debate. So in that way, I kind of welcome the debate. But the idea that ScopeX is intrinsically harmful is clearly ludicrous. The idea that it creates a social license for further solar geoengineering experiments, which might be a way that some of its more sophisticated critics might choose to attack it, ends up being sort of like really quite profoundly illiberal. I mean, if you don't want a discussion to happen, saying that just the very basis of the discussion can't be allowed to happen because then the discussion might happen, I find it a very dangerous way of going. And I think that it's also to some extent counterproductive. But you know, I think that what Harvard has done to try and make sure that it has independent review is quite admirable. And I just don't see that, I can't see that there's a really good faith way of arguing against it, which doesn't mean that people can't argue against it.
Holly?
Yeah, I mean, the thing with this project is they have an advisory board. They planned a public engagement process that was going to be focused in this area in the US where they originally were going to do it, but then the company that builds the balloon realized they couldn't build that type of balloon, but there's this company in Sweden that could, so they moved it to Sweden. And then they made, in my view, a mistake because they thought they were going to test the balloon like empty without putting anything in and then do this public engagement consultation process before they flew the balloon with the stuff in it, but not realizing that even just flying the balloon empty of the stuff would be an issue. So anyway, this is what I learned on this web event today, which you can watch if you want to know more about that. So I think it's a challenge because now they need to go forward with more public engagement. One of the problems is right now, this area has a democratic deficit, by which I mean that, you know, there's maybe 100 people in the world that follow this really closely. So they're able to shape their discussion, including things like getting a project postponed or canceled or whatever, potentially. And then the other millions and billions of people who haven't heard about it don't have a chance to weigh in on either side. So I'm glad you're holding this type of event that's open to people all around the world, because we need a lot more of this.
We're nearly out of time, but there's two other topical things that it would be interesting to get both your views on. The first is that, of course, we've relatively recently still had a change of US administration to one that takes climate change somewhat more seriously. What would you like to see, either with regards to climate change generally or more specifically to do with the response in terms of some of the topics that we've been discussing this evening? What would you like to see from the from the current administration in terms of concrete actions?
I think that some of the things have been going in a good direction in terms of thinking about innovation for clean energy. I know people might think that's just, you know, that's a bipartisan thing that could last. So I'm thinking about, okay, what if another 2 or 4 years there's a red wave, what's going to last? And I think that the innovation stuff that they're doing is good. I think there's people within the Department of Energy that are thinking progressively about carbon removal, including environmental justice implications of doing it. And so in terms of what you can do with just, you know, without Congress at your back, I think they've made a good start anyway. Maybe Oliver has some thoughts.
Well, but I have one thought just on what you said, which is an administration that has Jen Wilcox working at the Department of Energy is better than one that doesn't. I think she's a leading person in carbon dioxide reduction and I think really admirable. More generally, I do think that it'll be interesting to see how this administration tackles climate geoengineering. The Obama administration got really scared off it by an early experience with one media interview with the Obama chief scientific advisor, John Holden, and they were quite neuralgic on the subject. I think things have changed a little bit since then. And you can get some idea of some of this by the fact that the man who is now the president's chief scientific advisor, Eric Lander, interviewed David Keith for a podcast not that long ago before he became the chief scientific advisor. So if you want a few thoughts about how the administration will think about this, that might be a good place to start. But I'd like to also warn slightly. And I found this very much when I was in the news side of things at Nature. It's almost impossible for American high-ups in scientific leadership or politics to talk about America's role in any intellectual undertaking other than in terms of leadership. We must reassert American leadership. We must establish American leadership. The idea that when there's a big ideas thing happening in the world, America needs to lead it is unbelievably... it's pablum in Washington. It's just how people think. I think it would be really, really damaging to the world and solar geoengineering for this to become perceived as something that America wants to do, because America, I think the world thinks quite rightly, that America cannot be trusted on climate change. And I think the idea that solar geoengineering is necessarily an American project would be massively deleterious, certainly to any hopes of rational discussion of solar geoengineering, but I think also potentially more generally. And that's a real problem, because most of the people doing the research are in fact in America. It's probably true of most people doing climate research. I mean, I'm sure America is massively overrepresented. Certainly people doing climate research using satellites, America is massively overrepresented. So there's a real issue there. And one of the reasons I'm very happy that I work with a group called SRMGI in the process of changing its name to Degrees, which actively finds ways to involve developing country researchers in working on solar geoengineering and in bringing their own questions and perspectives to the practice of solar geoengineering research. It's so important that this not be just a global North issue, not just a developed country issue, and certainly not just an American issue, because the American politics of climate are so toxic that it hardly bears thinking about. It is, of course, going back to the question about optimism and pessimism, what I think is likely to happen, but it's still a very bad thing.
And how about we end, because we're out of time now, on literally a one word answer on that optimism or pessimism. So you can choose one or the other, each of you. COP26, big climate conference at the end of this year. Are you in the optimism camp or are you in the pessimism camp? Holly.
Optimism. Relative. Relative optimism.
And Oliver?
I'm with Gramsci on this, the great Italian communist theorist, who talked about pessimism of the intellect, optimism of the will. You're not going to get anywhere by not being optimistic. Optimists make things happen in various different ways, but you're not going to be able to use that optimism to the best political effect if you're not rationally pessimistic about the way the world's going.
Oh, Oliver, that's practically a politician's answer. thank you very much.
Yeah, the way to get ahead in British politics is definitely quoting Italian communists. So ahead of the curve, Emily.
Thank you very, very much once again, Oliver, for joining us for one of these climate change lecture series events. And Holly, it's been a real pleasure to have you joining us this evening as well. Thank you very much. And I'm sure many people are now going to be pre-ordering your book for later in the year. Thanks again to Hugh Hunt and everyone else who's been involved in organizing this event and the others in this series. And there are many other climate related events as part of the Cambridge Festival. So please check out the Cambridge Festival website and tune in to other events throughout the course of the festival. Hope you have a lovely evening and rest of the weekend, and see you at this same event next year, hopefully.
Next year at the Eagle. Thank you very much, Emily.
Thank you.